also thanks to Buck and everybody working for Buck a lot for inviting me for the residency program, as well as the exhibition which will come up on 22nd of April. I'm also very glad to have this meeting with you today as a first public appearance of mine. This will be very much introductory talk. Let's say I start with my past, and I will present some of my work which I have done in the last couple of years. And the second meeting will be take place on the 4th. No, I'm sorry. It will be on 22nd of April. Also at Buck, and before there will be another another meeting with the Haegue Yang MA students at Haegue, I guess. And the last thing will be after the opening of the exhibition at Buck, which will be on 2nd of May. I'm very glad to open this series of encounters with people in Utrecht. And I will just start with the explanation what is showing right now. Some images from the videos called Restrained Courage from 2004. We will come back to these video pieces later. I want to start with a quotation of Giorgio Agamben, who is an Italian philosopher. And this quotation is from very recent, I don't know if I can call it even an essay, because it's nothing but a very short statement of him on his relation and thought about notion of movement in relationship with Antonio Negri, who he worked in great deals together, but there it seems like there are some disagreements between them. And I found the Agamben's comment on movement quite interesting, not only as a notion of movement, but also in terms of what art could be for me and how I approached my work by myself. I will just read this short quotation to you first. Another interesting aspect in Aristotle's is that the movement is an unfinished act without telos. Telos is like a purpose or the final goal or something, which means that movement keeps an essential relation with a privation, an absence of telos. The movement is always a constitutively the relation with its lack, its absence of end or ergon, or telos or opera, whatever. I always disagree with Antonio Negri about this emphasis placed on productivity. Here we must reclaim the absence of opera as central. This expresses the impossibility of a telos and ergon for politics. Movement is the indefiniteness and imperfection of every politics. It always leaves a residue. Maybe I will comment on this quote just shortly, that movement is something very lively, and Agamben is insisting in this short statement that when people make the movement as a passage to a certain purpose or goal, that we cannot call it anymore as a movement. Movement stops when the movements take its realistic form. So that's what he's saying, that it has it stands in certain relation with the absent, lack, or impossibility. Even though it's not necessarily mean nothing is possible, it makes things possible, but it's not in the passage to achieve or accomplish a certain goal. I will stop this video now. We'll play it. I prepared the first group of work which have all to do with maybe some kind of communication without words, kind of non-verbal communication, or we can even call it maybe the absence of message or storytelling. This work called Traces of Anonymous Pupil Authors, which based on some Korean textbook, I have collected these kind of Korean textbook for school children for many years, and have looked at them for a while. And there were so many handwritings of students in these used books, and I found it extremely interesting how individually they deal with this monotonous way of education. Since the education in Korea has been quite academic and strict, that you really had to learn it by heart. Many things you have to learn it by heart. You will see, like, for instance, those kind of lines that somebody really tried hard to memorize things. The second page is also from the same person. We obviously see some handwritings. And this is different person. And this is nothing but a black and white prints of school books on which I removed all the printed letters. So let's say the given structure of education has been removed or disappeared, and only the individual relationship with this given system is left. And also it was very interesting for them, because for me, to see those lines and drawings, because it was very unpretentiously done. I mean, nobody really had an idea what kind of line I would draw to accomplish any kind of drawing qualities, but I saw some quality of individual, maybe it's a kind of strength, I don't know how to call it, but when I removed the given text or printed letters, finally the handwriting or sign becomes significant, and in this way, I think that there are two layers of things which were contained in original textbook, but I removed the one layer which was too dominant for the other layers. In this way, I revealed the hidden layers of individuals. And of course, I had like hundreds of pages, but I selected several pages and put them in a line, altogether 16 pages, that it gets it gets a certain kind of dramatology. And this, I found it very, especially very funny with this bracket, like too many brackets, and it's seems like the person used the bracket as an important thing, but usually we don't use the bracket as a marking of the important thing or significant thing. This one is quite monotonous, for instance. The drawings doesn't only showing enthusiastic way of learning or adjusting oneself to the given educational system, but also such a strong indifference to the material which they had to learn. In this case, it's very obvious the indifferent attitude towards the given system. This was the last page. And since these students are also the minority of the society who cannot define their environment by themselves, this drawing especially seems to me quite subversive expression, but very hidden. I think that was the sympathy I got from the original secondhand textbooks, and which attracted me a lot. And I have to admit that I feel quite same as them in terms of, I think that most of you also felt the same way, that you have the willingness or some desire to deal with things differently than it's supposed to be, but you are not the one who is active enough or legitimated one who can change or define the environment by yourself. And in this sense, they are the subject of the educational system, but this educational system is not generated by the students, or at least that time the students were not, let's say, the forces who can influence the educational system much. And this mute way of expression of the students were so strong that it was silent but strong enough that I pay attention to this material, I guess. Just one thing, if there is any question or remark, I'm happy to be interrupted by you, so, yes.
What was the age of the students?
This was the school textbook from the middle school, meaning from 13 to 16, I guess. And some books, and it was very interesting that I had like whole range of textbooks from English, mathematics, physics to household, which were only for girls. And the most of pages of my selection were originated from so-called not important majors, such as techniques, industry, sociology, like the important thing you had to put a great stress on were like English, Koreanistic, mathematics, those kind of things. Like, these books were like more history, household techniques and stuff. So, and they are also not that young, and they are not that like far, like high school students, they were kind of in between. The second work I want to present called Illiterate Leftovers. And these are nothing but these are also kind of graphic work. In the exhibition, I show them as a slide projection in the size of A4 sheet, black and white, as you see. And the original material were created through a procedure of mute communication via fax, that I sent the blank page to somebody, and the person who received the fax sent me the exact blank page which arrived back to me. Oh, I'm sorry.
So, what was the context of the exhibition? Is this a solo project or was it in the context of the group exhibition?
No, as well as the first work which I have shown, this project was not initiated for a specific exhibition or commissioned for a specific project. When I started collect this fact thing and exchange the blank pages with people who I knew, I was in Paris, and as usual, as soon as I arrived in a new place, I bought all the communication devices such as a mobile phone, fax machine, telephone, etc. And I send a blank page to somebody to test my new fax machine. And the person, I called the person and then asked to send the fax to me back. So I had a kind of very interesting result, which obviously showed my fax machine is working, but there was something others on the blank page. And for some reason, I found the page very interesting at home on the wall. Then I was just looking at the fact sheet, and at some point I started to exchange some more pages to see like what I can get. And I think the whole project, the whole period of time that, in which I collected the fax machine were over 2 years. And even if I have collected over 300 pages, I still didn't know what they are and what I'm going to do with them. And I just didn't have any clue why I collected them. And like slowly, the meaning of this empty empty way of communication, or empty I would say even it's a ritual of communication, seems to me significant enough that I decided to develop as a piece of work. Now I'm a little bit lost. What was the exact question? Sorry.
The question was in what kind of context you developed this project. So because you were telling about some kind of slight projections.
I see.
So I was wondering in what kind of context did you project this image?
I see. Yeah. No, like when I had the all these fact sheets, then I started to think in what kind of end form I would like to present this experience with empty fact sheets in the exhibition. And for some reason, I like the idea to of transforming all these papers into the lights and place them just on the wall in the sides of the original A4 sheets. And I think I could also have an option showing them like Hannah Danofen's work that I made the huge work. idea of having only one sheet, but the image is showing the all different way of traces of this literary ritual, and the selection of images which I'm showing now to you are quite expressive, I have to say. Like, most of pages doesn't have anything except the headlines. Sometimes you see like this a little bit of black line on the corner. Probably it's rejected from the sheets are not drawn to the fax machine straightly. Or sometimes you see the corner triangle that the sheet was folded or something like that. It's very minimal in a way. Oh yes, the one thing at the beginning, as I mentioned, I exchanged the fax sheets with friends or people who I knew, but later on I collected some fax numbers from anonymous people through various institutions and exhibitions that people kind of get a small note of what I intended to do, and they submitted some fax numbers, and I sent the fax to them personally, and then they sent me the fax back. Also, I found the technique of fax quite interesting because it's very immediate and direct. It's like one-to-one, it doesn't really distort so much. But at the same time, it has quite old-fashioned images as a communication technique. Really like sending out the real piece of paper I liked a lot. And also like when I went to the store to buy a fax machine, like they were asking what kind of resolution I wanted to and how like the speed, how like 1 minute how many sheets could be go through. The third criteria of judging a fax machine was, I don't remember the third one, but these three criteria seemed to me quite crucial in terms of judging any kind of communication technique, as well as like personal communication, like how good you can communicate with somebody, like the quality or resolution, or how speedy or how quickly or easily as well as clearly you can transmit the message to somebody. And like those things were all included in a way in the fax machine, which is quite old fashioned. And there is another version of this work, which is rejected as a book in collaboration with two Dutch designers, Maude Moren and Daniel van der Velden, which you can see on the table later on. And the book called The Pages, in contrast to the work as a slide projection called Illiterate Leftovers. I think it's quite obvious that why I'm showing these two works as a kind of like the one category, that there is no writing involved. Like knowledge, etc. But we don't see any of them, and we see only even a trace or leftovers. And that I liked a lot in relationship with Agamben's quote that when the movement can be a movement, when movement stops to be a movement, etc. Next work called Relational Irrelevance. It's quite ironic title. This work is a light installation, consists of two elements, no, actually three elements, and all of three elements were visual. The first one is the ball-shaped hanging lamp. And the second one is the spotlight. And the third one we cannot see on in the picture, but it's a kind of timer. And the lamp, the hanging lamp, is illuminated by the spotlight most of time. In this case, which was my solo show at the gallery Barbara Lee in 2004, it was like 3 minutes lit by the spotlight, and only 3 seconds the light is illuminating by itself. I'm going back. So most of the time you see this, and then only for 3 seconds you see that the hanging lamp is illuminated by itself. So what I was interested in this constellation of lighting relationship was the both of elements are independent and autonomous, but they artificially pushed in the situation, they are kind of dependent through this timer, but in a way they could be only maybe for me it is like almost an either a portrait of portrait of the relation of two people, or a kind of landscape that you can observe around you, what's happening with people in human between human relations. I will show them different versions also. This was another solo show of mine in Darmstadt. In both of shows, this light installation was installed in a kind of transitory or not primarily showroom corner or part of exhibition space. In the gallery in Berlin was a kind of corridor between a bookshop and exhibition space, and in Darmstadt it was like former book corner, which was not used anymore. So it was just as it is, and nobody has a reason to go in this space. So I lit up in those of like leftover spaces within, let's say, art institution or art spaces. But I have to admit, I showed this piece in a huge group show. But as far as I know, when this work was installed for the third time in Karlsruhe, this was unfortunately not in those kind of leftover spaces, like straightforward exhibition space, but actually this work, I would insist this work deserved a kind of leftover space to be installed. This work called Remote Presence from 2001. The space in the picture is a cafeteria of an art center in Seoul, Korea. And what I did in this situation was just removed one of these cafeteria's chair and replaced it with my mother's chair, which you can recognize in the picture, I guess. It is somehow difficult to miss that one chair is different than the others, kind of disturbing this corporate look of museum's cafeteria. At the same time, the chair is located where the chair should be, so it's kind of contradictory way of existence. It's initialized or initiated through this project that on one hand, I still fulfilled what has to be in the cafeteria, but slightly different way. And at that time, my original motivation was I could not go to the exhibition to realize the project, and somehow I portrayed my own situation of remoteness through my mother's chair, and it's quite intimate and personal, even private, but at the same time, that's the way how I could relate to the audience and the corporate identity, corporate idea of the art institution. I think this aspect we can come back later. Also, this discrepancy between like private, personal, and public anonymous is visible in other works, especially works consist of the furniture. This work called What I Would Like to Have at Home. From 2001, so another kind of furniture piece, and I think you could quite imagine what I have done through the title of the work. These two kind of furnitures were what I would like to have at home, which I got through the sponsorship for the exhibition, meaning that the need of private apartment has been accomplished in the exhibition space, and I spent in fact a lot of time to find these two furnitures. The first one is a sofa by Egon Eiermann, who's a German architect. It's a design and Egon Eiermann was the architect who built the West Germany's parliament in Bonn, and this sofa was was in designed for the Parliament building in Bonn, and so it's like kind of design classics. The other piece is the metal rack shelves, which you can put into to put together without any single tools. It is supposed to be a rather for industrial spaces such as workshops and factories than offices and rooms. And this company maybe doesn't really put a great value on appearance and aesthetics. But for me, it looks really good enough that I really wish to have it at home instead of the normal bookshelves. And when I contacted the company as well as the company of the shelves, as well as the dealer of the design classic furniture, they both were agreed to sponsor these for the exhibition. And I think when I asked them for my private need at home, nobody were ready to provide them. So there was a kind of the situation in which I interchanged with each other. Like the what is fulfilled, what is asked, and what is desired, and all these questions were just mingled up and expressed as another picture of two furnitures. And I think this piece, as well as the previous piece, communicate either very quietly or without telling so much story, but like telling enough as the graphic pieces that really reveal something. Another example of the furniture is how I make the relationship between the anonymous and the intimate as a picture or landscape, a picture of landscape or portrait of somebody. This work called the VIP's Union from 2001. I think you are familiar with the art fairs all over the world, and this work was commissioned by art fair in Berlin. They were quite proud of giving a commission to the artist for designing two public spaces at the art fair. The first one is press room, and the second one is VIP rooms. And every year, these two spaces were commissioned to be designed by the artist. And in 2001, I was asked to design the VIP room, where the dealer, galleries, and collectors meet, and you can enter only with the VIP pass. It's supposed to be communicative enough, but not bothered so much from the mass visitors at the art fair. And instead of making like fancy, arty furniture in the environment, I borrowed the furniture from my friends in Berlin. Some of them are from their apartment, but most of them are from their studios. The title, the union, was the metaphor designing of this autonomous aesthetic of autonomous way of expression through furniture, which I observed in student union at the universities or workers' unions in the factories, that usually they don't really design their space buying things. They just brought them from their own home, which are not used anymore, or adopted furniture from the street they collected for the students' room. So, like, some of them are really from the bourgeoisie household, or some of them has quite well designed, but the main point is they don't really make any corporate imagery of interior, and that was the main idea for designing this VIP room. And on the wall, you see the kind of thick black gray belt all along the four sides of the wall. And this band is tilted just 1 degree, so it goes up on one side and then coming down 1 degree, coming up 1 degree, coming down again exactly 1 degree. So it creates kind of belt that it really unified the ensemble of furniture in this room. Do you see some of the images?
There were some reactions
to this. The reaction was really heavy somehow. I don't know, the first day of the art fair, the VIP, so-called the VIPs, rushed to this room and used this room so heavily that they really made such a mess in this room. I mean, what you have seen is like the first stage of how I set the furniture. But usually, you know, the VIPs has like their own manner of the nice manner of manners and behaviors. But they were so wild and like there were garbages everywhere, and I have to say that I was like so unhappy with how they deal with the rooms that I was very sad. But in a way, that was probably the unconscious stimulation through the furniture on VIPs, I guess. Not only only the furniture as well as the lighting, so you see the exact angle of the patterns on the floor. And I also arranged the books not according to theme and or topics, but to the colors. So you see that kind of black and green and purple. And on the front, it's more obvious. But it was a big hassle to arrange them on my own way because the museum's personnel, some of the museum's personnel didn't like it. And they had like their own accustomed way of arranging things, and they didn't. Some of them enjoyed a lot to be in the middle of exhibition, but some of them didn't like so much because people, the audience, the visitors of the museum were very much irritated. They had to pay in the exhibition where they have seen the exhibition already. So in a way, I kind of make upside down a hierarchy of space ordering. But in very formal way as well, like some, like the first impression is like it is very aesthetic and formal way of rearranging, but at the same time it was kind of social rearranging of how you enter the museum and when do you pay and when do you buy the souvenir, etc. So it's strange that you lock your coat on the right side and you see the books and the museum souvenirs, but at the same time you have to pay even though you have a feeling you haven't seen anything in the museum. So that was kind of the conflict between me and audience as well as the museum's personnel and the artists. This piece has quite similar approach to the previous one. This work called Parents Rendezvous. It's quite strange title. I think one of the most strange titles which I've never ever had. Also, I introduced whole museum's cafe and souvenirs in the main exhibition room as well as the garderobe room. But differently than the Darmstadt, this room was also used for showing art at the same time. So the other side of the wall, you see some art piece of the other artists as well. And the museum's lobby or entrance hall is also used as exhibition space because the lobby was finally emptied from all these heavy art shop items. So it's somehow like you gain more space for the art, but at the same time also the hierarchy of spatial order of an art institution has been interrupted. So the you see the woman with the cashier, she is like deepest corner. She's now sitting in the deepest corner of exhibition space. So like when you arrived at her desk, then you already entered the end corner of the space. the situations are selected which were controversial to each other, like private and official and institutional versus private, etc. In this case, I also had kind of conflict situation of lack of space and offer of space. I had so many works scattered around in museum storage to galleries, cellar, that everybody at some point shouted at me and calling me up, asking when I'm going to pick them up. And I definitely didn't have any space to store them. But at the same time, I an invitation of solo show in a gallery in London. So like half as a half joke, I submit the proposal to store all of my previous work in the gallery space, which is a commercial gallery. So what you see on the picture is the result of so-called storage piece, 2004. So these pieces have traveled around much, like first to be realized as a piece of work, but also traveled then to be stored, and finally they arrived in another storage, which is not a real storage. I found it quite funny to see them packed and piled up on the Euro palette as a kind of monolith-like sculpture. Once the pictures or sculptures are packed, then that's the state of inactivated, that we don't regard them necessarily as an art piece. Okay, we handle them as an art piece, but it's not really rebuild their own quality and visuality as an art piece. And I focused on this not activated status of art piece, which I could also translate it as potenza, the concept of the agamben often mentioning. And potenza could be translated as potential, but agamben is especially focused on the potenza as let's say if I'm not writing poetry, then he wouldn't necessarily call it as potenza. But if the poet doesn't write the poetry, then that's the situation of the potenza. Potenza is contained. And in this case, you see the art pieces, even in the art space, but not really rebuilding them or pretend them as an art piece on the wall or in the space. So that's how I connect with agamben in the first like primarily in regarding this piece. But also in the political sense, as I quote before, when the work could be politically significant enough was a question which I pose to myself very often. I had a, I don't know, like I have a like, very different kind of interest on things in my surroundings. But in a way, I could not really address to specific issues of politics or economy in my work, and that was somehow somehow what I liked to, but I could not answer why I'm going this direction and not really make a field research as the other artists are doing. Even though you could, of course, approach this piece in terms of art as a commodity or translation, transportation as military-like globalization of world economy or whatever, but I liked the idea of having this as a not building a work, but building a philosophical idea of potentials. But I'm not really denying any other interpretations, but I prefer this way than the other ways, let's say. Additionally, I want to mention there was a performance to this piece. The opening, the two actors were reading some script, very ironical and controversial script, which I wrote on those topics and aspects contained in this work. At some point, I started writing lots of texts for my work, about my work, with my work, around my work, etc. And this work is mainly a photographic piece, consists of 9 pictures as well as one text, one analyzing text on a sitting table. You see the each images here. The whole piece called The Social Conditions of the Sitting Table, and that's the sitting table which I found in quite intimate domestic area of Korea, and I will read some part of this analyzing text that you could see that why I was attracted to portraying them at the beginning. These pictures document various forms of the sitting table, which without having a specific name is generally known in Korea and to be found in front of shops and residential buildings, places where the private and public spheres meet. I knew about these sitting tables, but the naturalness of their everyday existence left no specific impression on my personal landscape. After I finally realized their peculiarity, I was surprised at the social relevance of these inconspicuous objects and started to consciously search for them. I slowly realized the commonly used sitting tables are a statement of nameable social conditions. Sitting tables are the visual proof of certain way of life which is on the verge of disappearing unnoticed, but like the tables themselves. My search for them resembles the expedition of a botanist examining the conditions of development of this way of life in the city's biotope. The desire to communicate is essential, and in a literal sense, the sitting table is a communication platform developed over a long period of time and in unspoken this agreement between the users themselves. This unspoken agreement is mirrored in the formal design, as well as in their use. For example, the autonomous placing and the tie to social context. Maybe I will explain a little bit additionally. These sitting tables, I call them sitting tables, but somehow like this is not the traditional sitting tables that we can find the origin of this sitting table. And they are usually placed between public and private space, in front of, as you see, the yellow line divides the pedestrian way and the motorway. And this is somehow on the edge, and like somebody initiated this sitting table, but it's not necessarily belonging to the somebody who built or put it in the location. Like everybody are allowed to share this sitting table. So as the design idea of student union or workers union, I also very much interested in the design and the use of this sitting table as a socially significant phenomena, which also did not really address union so much, as well as not investigated much. Maybe they are not significant enough, or they are not obvious enough to be investigated. But that was the attraction which I found on these tables. And they're cheaply made. It was like, for me, finding nameless flowers in the city, which grow everywhere in the city. And I think now I will move to very different category of work, where the lots of very talkative words, maybe, lots of talking. Suddenly I started to speak to the audience. I think I finally ready to speak for myself in very direct way, but as well as very indirect way, because I invited other people who spoke for me, and this is called Speaker's Corner, which was shown at the Busan Biennale 2004. It was a video projection of six different people talking, reading my script. So they read the same script. Each person read the same script for me. Journalist, actors, lawyer, radio performer, musician, as well as poet. And they all something to do with professionally, something to do with speaking or act of speaking. It doesn't matter, performing way of speaking, or rather literary way of speaking, like they have something to do with rhetoric or act of speaking. And act of speaking was a kind of concern which I'm also talking about in the script, in relationship with what is the participation of the exhibition. And when I invited by the Busan Biennial, I was strongly questioning to myself, what is the participation of an exhibition, especially those kind of huge biennial, and then what is the contribution, what can I do as a single artist? And all those questioning confessional tone was included in the script. It's not really linear so much. Like some part I was very skeptical and even frustrated with situation in which I found myself, and some part I'm very provocative and still believe in subversive way of expressing myself as an artist, and it's quite mixed. And when I wrote this script, I didn't want it to have like fabricated idea of artist statement, and somehow very chaotic. So some of the collaborators will even slightly change the expression a little bit, which I of course allow to them, because I also wanted to have very strong their own rhetorics reflected in reading this script. So what you had the show was six very different versions of artist statement carried by professionals who has something to do with rhetorics. Now, unfortunately, I can only show the images of the speakers, but anyhow, this was the poet. Anyhow, what you have, like my space became kind of speaker's corner, that everybody felt free to speak for themselves finally. And of course, it's not their opinion, but somehow I felt better mediated through their own voices. This was a radio performer. Oops. The other kind of other way of questioning the participation of show was formulated with collaboration with other people in this work, called conditionally extended invitations, the more the better. I had to explain the long story of what kind of show it was. The invitation came from the Proto Academy, which is still active in Edinburgh, Scotland, and is an artist and researchers collective. They invited me to do a project in their showroom, and since they are not the exhibition makers, I didn't feel right to make another kind of exhibition with my huge, not only because of my huge hesitation or reluctant attitude toward the exhibition participation. And what I did was, I had a certain amount of budget provided for my show, so I spent all the budget to invite people as many as possible. So we were just there for 2 weeks and spending the budget as economically as we could. So artists, historians, filmmakers, as well as the lawyers were together just in class in Edinburgh, and we did like as much as activities we could. And like this quantity is a kind of like ironical way of to address what we could really generate in terms of quality. Like sometimes I don't really feel like enough to fulfill the expectation. And in this case, it was also reflected why me and what is the expected identity of artists or role of artists. So I replace this expectation into the invitation of very abstract and random idea of lots of people. And of course, the other aspect was like local exchanges, like Edinburgh, like most of, I forgot to mention that most of people who I invited were from Frankfurt. So the exchange between Frankfurt and Edinburgh was also reflected in the work in terms of the meaning of exchange, since the none of these cities are like weird big city where things are really excessively happening. I think if I could have like more budget, I could like transport like half of art scene from Frankfurt to Edinburgh. Was really that both of city have quite small family like community, which is not necessarily bad. I mean, so there was also like belief in this friendship and. As well as the trust of people. Still no questions to interrupt. I have like two more words to present. And now I'm moving to, for me, most difficult category of works to mediate to the public. I will show the both of images that I can handle them together. Just to this work called Between Reason and Critique and shown in the Manifesta 4, 2002. And this work called Vita Activa, which is also a book titled by Hannah Arendt. I don't know if I have to explain the work itself first, or better to start with my difficulty, why I found them difficult to difficult to mediate. I will start what is installed, like some facts and data. This is a kind of architectural dead end of pumping, the former pumping station of City Frankfurt, which was renovated for the Manifesta 4. And meaning this space was not used even in the period of time when the building was active. So this is kind of like non-place within the building. And what I did was just install the fluorescent light on the ceiling as much as I could. And these lights are lit on for most of time and turned off for very short time, like 10 seconds. But when it turns off or turns on, it is flickering heavily, like as if they really take, they really have lots of effort to be turned on or turned off. And that's the, that's only detail which you could find in this world. Otherwise, quite straightforward, you can see even every single cables and all the mechanics is gone. And nothing was renovated or removed in the space. And this vita activa consists of one huge concrete hill and some, I call them stations, some sitting corners. Corners, specific activity is offered to do. You are not forced to do, but you could do. Like one corner, you can see the books you can read, and the second, the other station, you could write down something, some of the phrases from the book, and like in this way. You become a collective writers of one ironical storytelling. And then again, the books were selected by my brother, who is a passionate reader as well as a book collector. The other station, you see some meeting stuffs with some headset, where you could hear the cassette tapes. These tapes are recorded again in other smaller tables on the hill. And there, on this table, you can find some of the script from the other station. You read them and record them and make a tape. And this tape is also can be listened to the other audience who is meeting. So what I did with this station around this completely awkward concrete hill is a very absurd circle of working and labor. And what I'm questioning is how you could be active being in the exhibition as a person who has an active life, and this idea is of course like inspired by the Hannah Arendt's book, but what I wanted to but that was just initial inspiration, which I carried out through titles. But what I'm much more interested in was this lo-fi activity in the chain of production. And you are, in a way, playfully involved in this absurd chain of production. But then again, like you are the one who is, in a way, acting in front of this hill or around this hill, which is another metaphor for industrial development in my childhood in Korea. And you see some of these lightings hanging down from the ceiling, like half lighted on and half turned off, even though they could all on. Thank you. think naturally enough, as I move into more recent work, it becomes more difficult to sum up or articulate the idea into understandable words. And but definitely you will see the extended lines of those recent work in the exhibition coming up back in April. And as a kind of small, how do you call it, small coast of the coming exhibition, I want to show some more images of other video piece called Unfolding Places. And I have done, since 2004, I have done two pieces of videos, which is heavily loaded with spoken voice over the various footages of imagery. Unfolding Spaces, Places is, I called it, I gave it a kind of nickname, contemplative road movie. In fact, it shows lots of different spaces that you could feel the moving aroundings alongside of the video. But the tone itself is very introverted, that if it was a road movie, it will be like a more introspective road movie than extroverted. And the thought of places and losing oneself in moving around places is very confessionally. But the aspiration of finding a place is rather messianic. And I think the most of footages are not necessarily showing the landmark of each cities or places, that it could be everywhere. Building a kind of universal picture of small corridor or hidden ways, etc. And in both videos, as well as Unfolding Places and the Restrained Courage, there is a very strange artificial footages inserted between these found footages. I shoot them, but I call them found footages because I don't really shoot according to the written script. In Unfolding Places, you see this origamis flown around through the wind. I think I'm not intended to. I don't intend to introduce two video pieces thoroughly, since I will show them in the show in April with the third video piece, which is in production now. And when I started the Unfolding Places, I had a kind of trilogy in my mind. So you will see the completion of this trilogy in the show.
The third one will be produced here in Utrecht?
No, if I'm allowed weeks in advance, I will go to Brazil to shoot the third video. I think that even though some images are left of the unfolding places, I'm more or less done in terms of like offering information and statements. I'm ready to get some answers. I'm ready to get some questions from you.